Hello, it's me. I'm back to give you deja vu with another video about sea ice. Except this time, got a bit more of a hot take about why the Arctic ice packs a punch for the climate. The thin layer of ice floating on top of the ocean at the poles is known as sea ice. It's a vital part of the Earth system, and melting sea ice is one of the most classical symbols of a changing climate. But instead of just telling you why it's important or how it's changing, I'm going to give you the comparison you didn't know you needed. Here are four reasons why sea ice is like world heavyweight champion boxer Tyson Fury.
The Gypsy Ice King. I'll show myself out.
Maybe not the most obvious angle, but here's what makes sea ice so similar to the world champ. 1. It's variability. 2. It's had some serious low points. 3. It's unpredictability. And 4. Its ability to recover. Still not sure how that stacks up? Watch on to find out why it makes total sense.
First off, just like Fury's boxing career, Arctic sea ice has had its peaks and troughs.
Sea ice waxes and wanes throughout the year, increasing in both area and thickness in the cold winter months, and decreasing again in summer when melting takes hold. And there are ups and downs year to year too. In some years, sea ice does pretty okay, while in others, it plummets. Sea ice forms on top of an ocean at the freezing point of seawater and starts out its life as thin first-year ice. That tends to be less than 30 centimeters. The length of a standard ruler. Once it makes it through its first melt season, it graduates to multi-year ice. And normally that's between 2 and 4 meters thick.
Or 1 to 2 Tyson Furies.
And once it reaches the grand old age of 4, it becomes known as old ice. Sad news for the rest of us. The thickness of sea ice can be used as a pretty decent indicator of its health, because if there's more multi-year ice hanging about, it suggests that melting isn't destroying all of the ice year to year. But unfortunately, there's a clear and alarming downward trend in the Arctic. You can see in this animation from Zach Labe that sea ice thickness has declined dramatically since 1979. Recent data suggests that the amount of multi-year ice has halved, and the amount of old ice has fallen by a staggering 95%. Coupled with a 13% decline in sea ice extent every decade, that's contributing to a huge fall in ice volume. And some new research has shown that Arctic sea ice thickness entered a new regime after a record low year in 2007. It was actually a quote from someone talking about this very study that got me going on this hot take in the first place. Walt Meier at the US National Snow and Ice Data Center compared successive years of warming and sea ice loss in the Arctic to the attrition of repeated punches in a fight. Individually, they might not be enough to be the fatal blow, but they prime the losing boxer for the big KO. And according to this new research, the KO came for Arctic sea ice in 2007. At the time, 2007 was the lowest minimum ice volume on record. It's since been trumped by 2012 and 2020. And it was this knockout punch that pushed Arctic sea ice into a new state. Those low moments are something else that Arctic sea ice shares with Tyson Fury, who famously lost the world titles that he won from Vladimir Klitschko in their 2016 unification fight, publicly spiraling into something of a nosedive while struggling with depression and addiction. This low point, and more generally the shift to a less icy Arctic, is having profound impacts on people and animals in the region. We're all familiar with the sad polar bear image that's so overused that it's basically a cliche. But for real, there are lots of Arctic animals that are really affected by sea ice loss. If you're an Attenborough fangirl like me, you'll know this. You might have seen the scene in Frozen Planet 2 with the super cute baby harp seal that's being taught by its mum how to swim. It's all very lovely until the mum disappears off into the sunset, like, yep, gotta go, kid, it's been nice knowing ya. And there's this moment that tears at your heartstrings where she looks back at the pup sitting on an ice floe, knowing she'll never see him again. And then it gets even darker when the camera pans out to show basically zero sea ice, and David Attenborough's voice comes in to say that in some areas, almost none of the baby harp seals survive because the ice is breaking up earlier and earlier every year, throwing baby seals into the sea before they're ready to swim. Like, Jesus, David, my heart, I am not emotionally prepared for this on a Sunday night. But it's not just the emotional rollercoaster element of fluffy animals dying, because ice loss impacts people too. First of all, there's the knock-on impacts for Arctic communities in terms of food security and cultural identity. People living in the Arctic have hunted animals like seals and narwhals for food for like ever, and changing sea ice conditions means that these traditional ways of life are becoming less and less possible. And less sea ice or thinner sea ice makes traveling much less safe for people who live and work in the Arctic too. In previous years, you could be pretty sure that the ice would be thick enough to bear the weight of your sled or your snowmobile, and that you could cover vast distances by going over the frozen ocean. But in many places, that's not such a dead cert anymore. When I was in Svalbard last summer, that's one of the most standout things that anyone told me, that just a few decades ago, you used to be able to cross the fjord over the sea ice on a snowmobile. Now you can't. Okay, here's my next reason. Tyson Fury is renowned for being an awkward, unpredictable fighter. And that unpredictability is something else that he shares with Arctic sea ice. Over the long term, we can predict that sea ice will continue to decline as long as Arctic temperatures keep rising. But in the shorter to medium term, it's pretty difficult to predict how sea ice will behave. That's because sea ice is influenced by so many different factors. Ocean temperatures, wind patterns, atmospheric temperatures, storms, clouds, and ocean currents all have a major role to play in how sea ice moves and changes. The ups and downs we see every year in sea ice cover makes it much less easy for Arctic communities to predict sea ice conditions weeks or even months in advance. You might be thinking, okay, so sea ice affects people and animals in the Arctic, big deal, doesn't impact me. But actually, sea ice affects all of us because it has a profound effect on global climate. Psych! Because sea ice is so bright and white, it acts like a big mirror, reflecting the sun's rays right back out to space. The more reflective it is, the higher its albedo, and that's a term that tells you how much energy is absorbed versus how much is reflected.
Albedo you up!
This keeps the Arctic cool because most of that energy gets bounced right back before it can do any heating at the surface. And a cold Arctic is critical for a stable global climate. Remember that study I was on about earlier? Albedo is central to the author's argument that Arctic sea ice has tipped into a new era of decline. That's because of a really important process called the sea ice albedo feedback. As temperatures in the ocean and atmosphere rise and more sea ice is lost, more dark ocean water underneath gets exposed. That dark ocean has a much lower albedo than bright sea ice, so it absorbs much more energy. That energy heats the ocean further, driving more melting in a reinforcing cycle. That cycle is at the heart of why the Arctic is warming nearly four times faster than the rest of the planet. And because of this, some people talk about Arctic sea ice loss as a tipping point. This study suggests that Arctic sea ice has shifted into a new mode where sea ice is much thinner and much younger than before. They argue that this step change in sea ice conditions is evidence of a tipping point. To go back to Walt Meier's analogy, the knockout punch has been delivered, and Arctic sea ice is in a state which makes it impossible to recover.
10, that's it, fight's over. Done.
Personally, I disagree that Arctic sea ice is a tipping point because I'd say that sea ice loss is reversible in a way that the loss of ice sheets or rainforest, for example, just really aren't. As soon as Arctic temperatures stabilize and begin to cool again, as optimistic as that seems right now, sea ice can recover almost instantly. That's pretty different to, say, ice sheets, which once they're lost, would require temperatures way colder than pre-industrial temperatures to regrow. And this is the last reason that sea ice is like Tyson Fury. Because if we manage to drive down greenhouse gas emissions and temperatures begin to decline again, some kind of last minute miracle comeback is still possible. If you've never watched it, I'll paint you a picture of what happened in Wilder Fury 1, the first edition of a fight to win all of the world's heavyweight titles. A matchup between Deontay Wilder, a heavy-handed power puncher, and Tyson Fury, a gigantic, awkward, unpredictable maverick. The fight was fiery, with both fighters landing pretty heavy blows, and Fury actually even falling to the canvas before returning to his feet in the ninth round. And then, in a plot twist that had fans standing up in their seats, in the final round, his opponent knocked Fury down and completely out. It looked like he was never gonna get up again. Wilder was so convinced that Fury was done, he was running around the ring celebrating his victory. But in truly fairy tale fashion, Tyson Fury got up after that 12th round knockout to recover and continue the fight. And to see him rise from the ashes was honestly the kind of against all odds comeback that humanity will need to pull out of the bag to halt and reverse the pace of climate change and to restore Arctic sea ice.
Climate change is altering every system on Earth, and Arctic sea ice is the canary in the coal mine that offers us an early warning system. We're currently getting counted out by the referee in the 12th round, and we need to dig deep and find something within us to get up and fight on. It would also definitely help to have a suspiciously slow count from the ref, but unfortunately, all the evidence suggests that climate change is happening faster than predicted, rather than slower. That makes it all the more urgent to find the strength and the will to get up off the canvas, cut emissions, and take meaningful action on climate change. If you like this video and you want to support more elaborate analogies about climate change and polar science, then head over to Patreon, where you can join my growing community of supporters, including these top tier legends over here. Thanks to them, and thanks to you for watching all the way to the end. See you next time.